Hello, my dear students. Today we will discuss the important topics from geography and IR sections during the period of 22nd to 28th of March. So let's see which all topics we have today. In the geography section, we have quite a lot of topics. For example, spring equinox, Ken Betwa interlinking project, then tulip gardens of Jammu and Kashmir, then Earth Hour, Suez Canal, and we have a new item in news, that is the places in news. This is very important from the prelims perspective. And a lot of times we see that in the UPSC, MCQs are asked from the places in news. So here we have Etria and Cape of Good Hope in the places in news section. Then in the international relations, we have United Nations Human Rights Council resolution on Sri Lanka, Freedom Pineapple Campaign, and United Nations Institute for Training and Research, that is UNITAR. So let's move on to the first topic of geography, that is the spring equinox. This year, the spring equinox took place on March 20th in the Northern Hemisphere. So in this respect, what is important is what are equinoxes and why they are important. So the word equinox is derived from two Latin words, that is equus and nox, that is equal night. So equinox means when day, length of day is equal to length of night. This is the most important thing that you have to understand. There are only two times of the year when this happens, that length of day is equal to length of night. And why this actually happens is that because, see, this is the earth which is rotating around the sun. So the axis of the earth is tilted like this. Now if the earth is at this location, that is at this point, then its axis will be like this. So the northern hemisphere will be tilted towards the sun and the southern hemisphere will be tilted away from the sun. So it means that northern hemisphere will receive more light as compared to southern hemisphere during this, at this position. Okay. So it means that in the northern hemisphere, northern hemisphere day will be greater than night. Length of day will be greater than night. Okay. Similarly, if we see the location of the earth at this position, then the axis will be tilted like this. So northern hemisphere will be pointing away from the sun and southern hemisphere will be pointing towards the sun. So in this scenario, the southern hemisphere will receive more light as compared to the northern hemisphere. So the length of the day will be greater than length of night in the southern hemisphere. ठीक है, यहाँ पे northern hemisphere में ऐसा होगा, यहाँ पे southern hemisphere में ऐसा होगा. But at this location and at this location, है ना, the axis is like this. ठीक है, तो this axis is not, if you see it, if you can imagine it, then the axis is neither tilted towards the sun neither away. It is directly perpendicular to the sun rays. Okay, like for example, these are the sun rays and the axis is perpendicular to the sun rays like this. So in these two locations, this one and this one, the length of day is equal to length of night. So this is the important concept regarding equinoxes. Okay, for example, it is written over here that there are only two times when the earth's axis is tilted neither towards nor away from the sun, and this gives nearly equal daylight and darkness at all latitudes. These are referred to as equinoxes. There are two equinoxes. One is the vernal and one is the autumnal. And the equinoxes happen in March. One is about 21st of March and other is about in September. That is around 23rd of September. So, ye jo date at 23rd, 21st, these are not fixed. And actually, these dates can shift from 22, 23 and 20th. So, ye shift ho jati hai. 1-2 days, they can shift easily. Because each year is no, has a little bit of extra days in it. So this year the equinox was on March 20th. ठीक है. तो जैसे reason तो मैंने पहले ही समझा दिया. I have explained all the reasons, equal night or day के reason समझा दिए. Then this is the March equinox, this is the September equinox, and these two are called as solstice. These two are called as solstice. Here the length of day is, for example, here this is northern hemisphere, so here the length of day is maximum length of day. Okay, and in the southern hemisphere, that is the minimum length of night, maximum length of night is there in the southern hemisphere. So this is called the June solstice. Here the day sabse bada din hota hai, the day is the lengthiest in the northern hemisphere, and in this location it is called the December solstice, winter solstice. So here the length of day is minimum in the northern hemisphere. So these are the four important locations of the earth. And why are they important? Because they are the signals to change in the seasons, seasonal change. is indicated or is initiated by the position of the earth in this area, है ना. For example, from here, if the earth is here, from here when it is moving like this, so it means that summer is over and now the seasons will change a little. And from here, this is the winter season here. Now, if the earth is moving like this, so it means that the winters are getting over and the earth is slowly moving towards the summer. Okay. So this is the time of the spring and this is the time of the autumn. ठीक है. तो देर आर टू इक्विनॉक्सेस, वन इज द ऑटमनल इक्विनॉक्स एंड वन इज द वर्नल इक्विनॉक्स. देन द नेक्स्ट टॉपिक इज द केन बेतवा इंटरलिंकिंग प्रोजेक्ट. रिसेंटली द गवर्नमेंट ऑफ उत्तर प्रदेश एंड मध्य प्रदेश हैव साइंड अ मेमोरेंडम ऑफ अंडरस्टैंडिंग विद द जल शक्ति मिनिस्ट्री टू इम्प्लीमेंट द केन बेतवा रिवर इंटरलिंकिंग प्रोजेक्ट. तो वट इज दिस लिंक प्रोजेक्ट? दिस इज द फर्स्ट प्रोजेक्ट अंडर द नेशनल प्रस्पेक्टिव प्लान फॉर द इंटरलिंकिंग ऑफ रिवर्स. It involves transfers of surplus water from the Ken to the Betwa. This is the main important thing. From Ken to Betwa, the water is being transferred. And both these rivers are the tributaries of the Yamuna. This is also important. So this can be asked in the prelims MCQ type of question. And for this, a canal will be dug. That is the from the Dhaulan Dam, and a 221 kilometer long canal will be dug. So this is the project. From Ken to Betwa we are transferring the water. So this is the Betwa river and this is the Ken river. From Ken to Betwa we are transferring the water through this Dhaulan Dam and this link canal. Okay, this link canal which is there. So the canal needs the approval of the share of the center and the state in funding, forming the new organization of Ken Betwa Link Project Authority. This new organization will be formed to execute the project and obtain the stage 2 forest clearance for construction of the Dhaulan Dam. So Dhaulan Dam bhi pooch sakta hai aapse, Dhaulan Dam kaun si project se linked hai, ya fir Dhaulan Dam is on which river. So iska answer hoga Ken river. The project will be completed in 8 years. Theek hai. To Ken aur Betwa river ke bare mein kuch important information, that Ken Betwa originate in MP and are tributaries of Yamuna. Ken river meets Yamuna in the Banda district of UP and with Betwa in the Hamirpur district of UP. Rajghat, Paricha and Matatila dams are over the Betwa river. Ken river also passes through the important Panna Tiger Reserve. Then factors involving favoring the interlinking of rivers. Why do we want to interlink the rivers? Because in our country the rain is coming from monsoon only. So monsoon, the rain is concentrated only in the 100 days, around 100 days. So in this short amount of time, we receive all the rainfall that we can. Now, rest of the days, we do not receive any rainfall. So this creates an abnormality where there is excess of water in some rivers and there is a shortage of water in the other rivers. So this problem can be sorted out by interlinking of different rivers. And India also needs to enhance its food production. So for the food production, we need irrigation, water for irrigation, and this interlinking of rivers can provide water to those areas which are facing shortage. So this can solve multiple problems. For example, the problem of floods during the time of the monsoon can be solved by diverting excess water from the rivers which are heavily flooded to the basins which are shortage in the water supply. So floods also can be solved. Then droughts also can be solved because we can transfer excess water to the shortage area. So droughts, the problem of droughts can be solved. Then the problem of food and irrigation also can be solved. Then these canals will also provide transport facilities for the transportation of goods and people. So they will also provide inland waterway can also be built by this type of connections between the rivers. Theek hai. So it can help in increasing connectivity by creating more inland waterways, and interlinking of river will increase India's utilizable surface water by 25%. So we can, right now a lot of water is just flowing into the oceans, we are not able to use it, but if we implement interlinking of rivers, then we can use a lot of river water. Then it can also lead to generation of 100 megawatts of electricity. Okay. and this project will be immense benefit to the water starved regions of Bundelkhand, and this will benefit a lot of people. This will pave way for more interlinking river projects in the future. So this can be a precedent to the next projects. But there are many issues. For example, the project will partly submerge the Panna Tiger Reserve in Madhya Pradesh, and it will affect the habitat of the vultures and jackals in this region. So there have been a lot of protests about this, and finally it has cleared by the Apex Wildlife Regulator, that is the National Board of Wildlife. We have already studied the National Board of Wildlife is the apex regulator in terms of wildlife related issues. So if you want to change the border of any national park, or if you want to change the border of any wildlife sanctuary, or we want to do anything in that area, so we have to take the approval for the National Board of Wildlife. Then there is the disagreement between the states. The two states could not agree on how water should be shared. Water sharing is a problem which has to be resolved. And the cordial conditions may not last forever, and disputes might arise in future when there are governments of different parties in UP and MP. And then there is the problem of the damage to the ecology. National Board of Wildlife has raised this problem that this project can have a potential damage to the ecology by submerging a lot of area, lot of forest underwater. Okay. And this project is also very costly. There is a huge cost attached to this project, and according to a comprehensive detailed project report, the cost of the project is estimated to be around 35,000 crore. This is a very huge cost, and whether the benefits will be more than the cost, that has to be analyzed. And in the benefits, we have to analyze the social benefit, the economic benefit, the disaster management benefit, the transportation benefit, other benefits, and for example the cooperation between the states, all these things has to be measured. And then we have to see the cost will include the ecological cost, the monetary cost, the cost of the displacement of the people, if there is displacement of people in that area. So all these costs have to be calculated, and then we can say whether benefits are greater than cost. Okay, so this is how we do the impact assessment of a particular project. Previous examples of interlinking of rivers, and in 1970 this idea originated that we should transfer surplus water from rivers from one river to the other, and this idea was proposed by the then Union Irrigation Ministry. Okay, then National Water Grid was constructed, which was suggested for transferring water from water rich areas to water deficit areas. In the past also, several river linking projects have been taken up. For example, the Periyar project, which transfers water from the Periyar basin to the Vaigai basin. Okay, it was commissioned in 1895. And similarly, there are other projects such as Parambikulam Aliyar project, Kurnool Kudappa canal, Telugu Ganga project, and Ravi Via Satluj project. So all these projects have precedent to the transfer of water from areas of floods to areas of droughts. Then what is this National Prospective Plan that we were talking about? It was developed in August 1980 by the Ministry of Irrigation. Okay. And it comprises of two components. One is the Himalayan River Development component, and one is the Peninsular River component. So as you know that India is divided into two. Virtually, India is divided into two. The Himalayan River component is this one, and the Peninsular River component is this one. So, India, this plan divides India into two parts for the plan's purpose, and the National Water Development Agency identified 30 river links, that is 16 under the peninsular component. 16 river, 16 linking projects are there in the peninsular component, and 14 river links are there in the Himalayan component. Then Ken Bedwa link project is one of the 16 river linking projects under the peninsular component. Then what is the way forward in this project? That the feasibility has to be studied carefully, and that we have to decide on the case by case basis. Then we can introduce public-private partnership to share the cost of the project, so that the pressure on the government exchequer is reduced. Then there can be a participatory approach to encourage the behavioral changes and community engagement in the groundwater management. For example, the entire problem is lack of water in a particular area. So for that, there can be other things that can be done. For example, rainwater harvesting and a groundwater management. So and change in the agricultural practices. ठीक है, एग्रीकल्चरल प्रैक्टिसेस इंक्रीजिंग वाटर यूज एफिशिएंसी, सो ऑल दीज थिंग्स कैन बी लुक्ड अपॉन है ना बिफोर वी कैन वी डिसाइड टू टेक ऑन दिस मैसिव इंटरलिंकिंग ऑफ रिवर प्रोजेक्ट. नाउ द नेक्स्ट टॉपिक इज अबाउट द ट्यूलिप गार्डन्स ऑफ जम्मू एंड कश्मीर. दे आर लोकेटेड एट द जबरवान रेंज, एट द फुटहिल्स ऑफ द जबरवान रेंज विद एन ओवरव्यू ऑफ द डल लेक. तो जबरवान रेंज इज अ short 32 किलोमीटर सब माउंटेन रीजन बिटवीन पिर पंजल एंड द ग्रेट हिमालयन रेंज. तो पिर पंजल जैसे आपने पढ़ा होगा हिमालयन रिवर्स, इसके बारे में, हिमालयन रेंजेस के बारे में. तो दिस इज द ग्रेट हिमालयन रेंज एंड ऑन द नॉर्थ साइड ऑफ इस इज द काराकोरम लद्दाख एंड जस्कर रेंज एंड ऑन द साउथ देर आर द पिर पंजल धौराधार शिवालिक हिल्स ऑल दीज थिंग्स. तो दीज आर द मिडल हिमालयस. नाउ so Zabarwan range is between the Pir Panjal and the Great Himalayan range, so in the central part of the Kashmir Valley. The famous Shankaracharya temple is built on the edge of this central part of the Zabarwan range, and on the northern slope of this mountain there are very beautiful garden, Chashmashahi garden, Nishant Bagh, Shalimar Bagh garden along the and there is also the Pari Mahal. So these are the very famous gardens of Kashmir. Whoever has gone to Kashmir to visit this must have seen these gardens, the Nishant Garden, the Shalimar Garden, Chashmashahi. All these gardens are very famous and they are located on the northern slope of the Jabarwan range. Theek hai. And India's largest tulip garden of Asia, largest tulip garden of Asia is also located here, and this was opened in 2007 for public, and the idea was to boost the floriculture and tourism in the Kashmir Valley. ठीक है, देर आर अ लार्ज वैरायटी ऑफ फ्लावर्स विच आर देयर एंड द ट्यूलिप फेस्टिवल इज ऑल्सो ऑर्गेनाइज ऑन द ऑनसेट ऑफ स्प्रिंग एंड इट्स अ पार्ट ऑफ द एफर्ट्स ऑफ द जम्मू एंड कश्मीर गवर्नमेंट टू बूस्ट टूरिज्म इन दैट एरिया. एंड द वेरी फेमस डचिगाम नेशनल पार्क विच हैज़ द फेमस कश्मीरी हंगुल, कश्मीरी स्टैग, इट इज़ अ वेरी फेमस एनिमल ऑफ कश्मीर. डचिगाम नेशनल पार्क इज ऑल्सो लोकेटेड इन दिस रेंज. दिस रेंज इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट फ्रॉम टूरिज्म एंड इकोलॉजिकल परस्पेक्टिव. Next is the topic of the Earth Hour. It is the global grassroots movement in which all the peoples of the world unite to take action on the environmental issues. It is organized by the WWF. ये पूछ सकते हैं आपसे, WWF organize करता है इसको. And it is started as Lights Out event in Sydney. ठीक है, 2007 में it was started as an event in which the people switched off their lights which were not in use. The annual Earth Hour Light Out event is held worldwide towards the end of March. March के खत्म होने पे ये होता है. And in this, there is 1 hour in which the people switch off all the lights which are not being used at the moment. ठीक है. तो basically the season which is chosen, the month which is chosen is March, because March में equinox होता है, जैसे कि हमने पहले पढ़ा. तो northern और southern hemisphere के sunset times जो होते हैं वो ऑलमोस्ट सेम होते हैं, तो इसलिए ये फायदेमंद है. एंड वी कैन सिंक्रोनाइज दैट, जैसे कि हम लोग सिंक्रोनाइज कर सकते हैं कि 6 बजे सबकी लाइट बंद हो जाएंगी, तो सनसेट टाइम्स के हिसाब से हम लोग सिंक्रोनाइज कर सकते हैं. फॉर एग्जांपल, इफ सनसेट इज अराउंड 6, तो वी कैन से दैट 7 से 8 हम लोग लाइट ऑफ करके रखेंगे. ठीक है, तो दिस विल हैव यूनिफॉर्म इम्पैक्ट इन द नॉर्दर्न एंड द साउदर्न हेमिस्फीयर. द आइडिया इज टू इंक्रीज द अवेयरनेस अबाउट द एनवायरमेंटल destruction that is being done or climate change ko fight karna, that is the main goal of this project. Then the next topic is the Suez Canal, and it was in news because a huge container got stuck in the Suez Canal and it has blocked off the traffic along the critical shipping lane. So we see this is the Suez Canal, you can see, and here a huge container and that with the name of Evergreen has blocked the entire Suez Canal. So this container was going through smoothly, but because of a heavy winds it got swayed away and it just blocked the Suez Canal. Now there is a huge delay in the reopening of the canal, which is having a huge impact on the export and the international trade, because a lot of trade, over 12% of the world trade, passes through this area, है ना? 12% of the world trade by volume and 30% of the container ships pass through this Suez Canal. It is the world's most heavily used shipping lanes. Therefore, this container is making huge news in the current affairs. Now, we have to understand some basic concepts about the Suez Canal. So, Suez Canal was built in 1869, and basically it provides a shortcut between the Mediterranean Sea and the Red Sea. So, this is the canal which was built. So, basically, it was a man-made canal. Humans dug this. This is the Sinai Peninsula over here, Sinai Peninsula. This is the Sinai Peninsula, and humans dug this canal to join the Red Sea and the Mediterranean Sea. ठीक है, दिस रिड्यूसेस द डिस्टेंस फ्रॉम एशिया टू अमेरिका बाय अ ह्यूज अमाउंट. ठीक है, इट इज़ 193 किलोमीटर लॉन्ग. द कैनाल इज सेल्फ इज 193 किलोमीटर लॉन्ग एंड इट्स इट वॉज एल सी वी विल सी सम हिस्ट्री अबाउट द स्विस कैनाल राइट नाउ. तो इन स्विस कैनाल इन 1858 द यूनिवर्सल स्विस शिप कैनाल कंपनी वॉज फॉर्म्ड. Its aim was to construct and operate the canal for 99 years, after which the canal would be transferred to the Egyptian government. Now, what happened is that in this company, French and the Britishers, they had the major share, majority of the shares. Okay. So then ultimately the canal was opened for public in 1869. Okay. So yahan pe canal open ho gaya. But in 1954, Egypt and Britain signed a 7-year treaty. For the withdrawal of the British troops from this island, this canal. Okay. So earlier, when the canal was opened in 1869, because the Universal Swiss Ship Canal Company, the Britishers had a major role in that. So the Britishers were maintaining a huge influence on this, on the working of this canal. Now, in 1954, Egyptian government signed an agreement with the British to remove the British from this area. अब 1956 में द प्रेसिडेंट ऑफ इजिप्ट दैट इज अब्दुल नसार ही नेशनलाइज द स्विज कैनाल इन ऑर्डर टू प्रोवाइड फॉर द पेमेंट ऑफ द बिल्डिंग ऑफ अ डैम ओवर द रिवर नाइल. ठीक है, नाइल रिवर के ऊपर डैम बनाने के लिए उन्होंने उसको नेशनलाइज कर दिया. नाउ दिस लेड टू द ह्यूज क्राइसिस विच इज कॉल्ड एज द स्विज कैनाल क्राइसिस. इसके ऊपर यूपीएससी हैज ऑल्सो आस्क्ड द क्वेश्चन. द स्विज कैनाल क्राइसिस में UK, France and Israel, all the three attacked Egypt. Finally, the conflict ended in 1957 when the United Nations was got involved, and United Nations positioned the United Nations peacekeeping force in this area. So this is the first instance in the world when the peacekeeping force was deployed in a particular area. This is the first action of the peacekeeping force. ठीक है, तो इसलिए ये भी important है. प्लस उसके बाद 1967 में देन द प्रेसिडेंट अगेन रिमूव द पीस कीपिंग फोर्स आउट ऑफ द सिनाई पेनिनसुला एंड दिस अगेन क्रिएटेड अ क्राइसिस इन विच द इजरायली गवर्नमेंट है ना, दे ऑक्यूपाइड द सिनाई पेनिनसुला और उसके रिस्पॉन्स में इजिप्ट ने क्लोज कर दिया कैनाल टू ऑल द शिपिंग्स. दिस क्लोजर कंटिन्यूड अप टिल 1975 तक ये क्लोज ही रहा. एंड फाइनली द टू कंट्रीज दैट इज द इजराइल एंड इजिप्ट दे साइंड अ कॉन्ट्रैक्ट so that the situation can be disengaged. And finally, when the Arab-Israel war took place in 1973, जब Arab-Israel war हुई थी उसमें अरब को जो लीड कर रहा था वो इजिप्ट और सीरिया थे. तो इजिप्ट और सीरिया जब लीड कर रहे थे तो अरब इसराइल वॉर में एक स्विस कैनाल भी एक बहुत इंपॉर्टेंट इशू था. द स्विस कैनाल वॉज ऑल्सो अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट इशू इन द अरब इसराइल वॉर ऑफ 1973. ठीक है, फाइनली द टू कंट्रीज साइंड अ कॉन्ट्रैक्ट इन 1975 एंड दिस नॉर्मलाइज द सिचुएशन इन द स्विज कैनाल. ठीक, तो अब कुछ और फैक्ट्स हैं कि इट इज कॉमनली बिलीव दैट द केप ऑफ गुड होप इज द साउदर्न मोस्ट टिप ऑफ अफ्रीका, बट केप ऑफ गुड होप की जगह साउदर्न मोस्ट पॉइंट ऑफ अफ्रीका इज केप ऑफ एगुलास. एंड ओपनिंग ऑफ स्विज कैनल वाज इन 1969 एंड इट प्रोवाइड अ शॉर्टर रूट टू द From the Mediterranean Sea to the Indian Ocean. ठीक है, now the important places in news, Eritrea and Cape of Good Hope. So for Cape of Good Hope, we have already seen this all this information that Cape of Good Hope तो इंडिया ने क्या किया है, इंडिया ने बोला है कि हम लोग अब जो है केप ऑफ गुड होप के थ्रू अपना सामान भेजेंगे, ठीक है। तो दिस इज सपोज दिस इज अफ्रीका एंड दिस इज द स्विस कैनाल ओवर हेयर एंड सो इट रिड्यूस द डिस्टेंस बिटवीन इंडिया, दिस इज इंडिया ओवर हेयर एंड नाउ वी आर प्लानिंग दैट वी विल सेंड ऑल आवर शिप्स एंड गुड्स अराउंड द केप ऑफ गुड होप, ठीक है। तो ये जो है दिस इज द इम्पॉर्टेंट थिंग बिकॉज ऑफ विच केप ऑफ गुड होप इज ऑल्सो इन न्यूज एंड स्विस कैनाल इज ऑल्सो इन न्यूज, ठीक है। तो क्योंकि ये स्विस कैनाल न्यूज में है तो आपको ये सारे जो कंट्रीज हैं और आसपास के सीज हैं यू शुड नो अबाउट दैम। फॉर एग्जाम्पल दिस इज द स्विस कैनाल ओवर हेयर, दिस इज द सिनाई पेनिनसुला, दिस इज इजिप्ट एंड दिस इज द रेड सी, दिस इज द मेडिटेरेनियन सी। तो ये सारा आपको पता होना चाहिए। दिस इज गल्फ ऑफ एडन, एडन इज समवेयर हेयर इन यमन। तो दीज ऑल इम्पॉर्टेंट प्लेसेज, वेन एवर सच थिंग्स कम्स इन न्यूज, सो यू मस्ट हैव एन आइडिया, यू मस्ट लुक एट द मैप एंड यू मस्ट अंडरस्टैंड वॉट आर द इम्पॉर्टेंट प्लेसेज विच आर देयर इन दिस लोकेलिटी, ठीक है। तो कई बार यूपीएससी क्वेश्चन पूछ चुका है इस एरिया के ऊपर कि विच ऑफ द फॉलोइंग कंट्रीज आर टचिंग द मेडिटेरेनियन सी। तो यू जस्ट गो एंड हैव अ गुड लुक एट द मैप ऑफ दिस एरिया बिकॉज दिस एरिया इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट फ्रॉम द इंटरनेशनल रिलेशंस पर्सपेक्टिव, ठीक है। तो यहाँ पे ये क्वेश्चन पूछता है कि कौन सी कंट्री का बॉर्डर इज लाइंग इन द मेडिटेरेनियन सी, ऐसे ही ये पूछ सकता है विच कंट्री हैज अ बॉर्डर, विच कंट्री हैज अ बॉर्डर विद द रेड सी, ऐसे पूछ सकता है विच कंट्री हैज अ बॉर्डर विद पर्शियन गल्फ, ठीक है। तो दिस दिस इज द पर्शियन गल्फ, दिस इज द गल्फ ऑफ ओमान। सो दीज आर द इम्पॉर्टेंट सीज एंड लोकेशंस इन दिस एरिया, सो जस्ट हैव अ क्लोज लुक एट द मैप ऑफ दिस एरिया, दिस विल हेल्प यू इन द प्रीलिम्स। नाउ इरिट्रिया वॉज इन न्यूज बिकॉज इरिट्रिया हैड डिसाइडेड टू विदड्रॉ द ट्रूप्स फ्रॉम इथोपिया आफ्टर 5 मंथ्स आफ्टर द कॉन्फ्लिक्ट इन द टिग्रे रीजन हैज स्टार्टेड। तो द प्रेजेंस ऑफ इटेरियन ट्रूप्स इन इथोपिया वॉज स्पेशली कॉन्ट्रोवर्शियल बिकॉज द टू कंट्रीज हैड फॉट अ बिटर बॉर्डर वॉर विच वॉज ऑफिशियली एंडेड बाय वेन अबिजे अहमद बिकेम द प्राइम मिनिस्टर इन 2018। इरिट्रिया इज अ कंट्री इन द हॉर्न ऑफ अफ्रीका, सो दिस इज वॉट इज कॉल्ड एज द हॉर्न ऑफ अफ्रीका, दिस दिस क्वेश्चन। तो इरिट्रिया इज अ कंट्री इन द हॉर्न ऑफ अफ्रीका। द कंट्री इज बाउंडेड टू द साउथ ईस्ट बाय जिबोती, टू द साउथ बाय इथोपिया एंड टू द वेस्ट बाय सूडान। सो एज आई मेंशन बिफोर यू शुड नो द लोकेशंस एंड इम्पॉर्टेंट सीज इन दिस एरिया, इम्पॉर्टेंट पासिस, बिकॉज दिस प्लेस इज ऑलवेज अ हॉटस्पॉट ऑफ फॉर इंटरनेशनल रिलेशंस। Now the next, coming to the next topic of IR, that is the United Nations Human Rights Resolution on Sri Lanka. Recently, the resolution on promoting reconciliation, accountability and human rights in Sri Lanka has been adopted at the 46th session of the United Nations Human Rights Council in Geneva. What is the resolution about? The resolution is it was the first to be voted on using the extraordinary e-voting procedures established under the 46th session, which was held virtually. The resolution was sponsored by a group of countries including UK, Germany and Canada. It is critical of Sri Lanka's failure to address the human rights violation. Jo bhi Sri Lanka ne fail kiya tha, Sri Lanka has failed to address the human rights violation during its fights against the LTTE. LTTE के अगेंस्ट जो भी फाइट हुई थी उसमें देर वर अ लॉट ऑफ रिपोर्टेड ह्यूमन राइट्स वायोलेशन एंड द रिजोल्यूशन हैज एक्सेप्टेड दैट श्रीलंका हैज फेल्ड टू एड्रेस द ह्यूमन राइट्स वायोलेशन विच ऑकर ड्यूरिंग द सिविल वॉर। द सिविल वॉर एंडेड इन 2009 ओनली एंड इट द रिजोल्यूशन कंटेंडेड दैट द राइट्स ऑफ डिफेंडर्स एंड एथनिक एंड रिलीजियस माइनॉरिटीज आर फेसिंग प्रॉब्लम्स, ठीक है। तो दिस रिजोल्यूशन इज अ बिग रिजोल्यूशन बिकॉज इट accepts that Sri Lanka has failed in certain terms and the people who are victims of this violence are not getting their rights, ठीक है। तो what is this reaction of the Sri Lanka? The government of Sri Lanka and Tamil National Alliance were expecting the exact opposite outcomes, है ना। तो both sides appeared sympathetic to the India's abstention. India abstained in this voting and this amounts to support for neither party. The TNA held that India must have decided to abstain after careful consideration of the various factors. So this is important that India abstained. Why did India abstain? Because Sri Lanka is in the very neighborhood of India and China is playing a strong role in the Sri Lanka's foreign policy. So China is slowly getting a strong foothold in Sri Lanka. Now, if India wants to strengthen its neighborhood and its presence in the Indian Ocean, then it is very important that India has a very good relationship with Sri Lanka. So this is also a consideration that must have gone into the minds before India abstained. ठीक है, and why did India abstain? India abstained from the vote under the belief that states have the primary responsibility for protecting human rights. It means that Sri Lanka is sovereign and Sri Lanka has the ultimate responsibility to protect the human rights of the peoples involved in that area. ठीक है, and India's approach to human rights in Sri Lanka is guided by two fundamental considerations. That is support to the Tamil minority for equality, justice, dignity, and peace, and ensuring the unity, stability, territorial integrity of the Sri Lanka. So India always believes that Sri Lanka is independent and it has the final authority in dealing with the human rights of its own people. ठीक है, तो वी हैव ऑलवेज बिलीव दैट द टू गोल्स आर म्यूचुअली सपोर्टिव एंड श्रीलंका प्रोग्रेस इज बेस्ट अश्योर्ड बाय साइमल्टेनियसली एड्रेसिंग द बोथ द ऑब्जेक्टिव्स. इंडियाज कंसर्न इन श्रीलंका हैव ऑलवेज बीन डिफरेंट फ्रॉम द रेस्ट ऑफ द इंटरनेशनल कम्युनिटी एंड इट इज इंडियाज कंसर्न हैज बीन इन्फॉर्म्ड बाय सेंस ऑफ लॉन्ग टर्म वेल बींग ऑफ द तमिल्स. सो वी आर फोकस्ड ऑन द लॉन्ग टर्म सोल्यूशन एंड नॉट द इमीडिएट सोल्यूशन, नॉट द शॉर्ट टर्म सोल्यूशन. तो इंडिया हैज ट्रेडिशनली शाइड अवे फ्रॉम बैकिंग such interventions, you know, because of its sensitive related to the Kashmir issue. So this is also important that if India votes in such a sensitive issue, then there can be other issues. For example, the human rights violation in areas where armed forces special powers act have been imposed, for example Kashmir. So therefore India always believes that it is the sovereign duty of the country to protect the human rights of the people, and it is the internal matter. The external forces should not interfere in this matter. So what is the important thing? Yeah, important thing is that India also supports the world community for Sri Lanka to fulfill the commitments on the devolution of political authority to Tamils. After the civil war was over in 2009, there was an agreement after some time that the Tamils in that area, which reside in the northern parts of the Sri Lanka, the Tamils should also get some political rights so that they can lead their lives with dignity, and there should be peace, and there can be peace in that region. So this devolution was passed by an amendment to the constitution of the Sri Lanka, and India supports the world community that Sri Lanka should implement those agreement. Then important facts about the UNHRC. It is an intergovernmental body within the UN system, and its goal is the promotion and protection of all human rights. It was created by the United Nations General Assembly on 15th of March 2006, and it has the ability to discuss all the issues related to the human rights. It meets at its office in Geneva, and it is made up of 47 member states which are elected by the United Nations General Assembly. It replaced the former United Nations Commission on Human Rights, and it also works with the United Nations Special Procedures. These special procedures are made up of special rapporteurs, special representatives, independent experts, and working groups that monitor, examine, advise, and publicly report on the issues of the human rights. Now, some history about the civil war in Sri Lanka. That after Sri Lanka got independence from the British in 1948, the Sinhalese people, they were in majority, and they started discriminating against the people of the Tamil origins. Okay, then Tamils were taken to Sri Lanka to work in the plantations by the Britishers. So Tamils were usually living in the northern part of the Sri Lanka. Now in 1972, the government dominated by the Sinhalese community decided to change the name of the country to Sri Lanka from Ceylon, and also made Buddhism the primary religion. Okay, now the ethnic tensions began. So in 1976, there was an organization called the Liberation Tigers of Tamil Alam, that is the LTTE, which was formed under the leadership of Villupillai Prabhakaran. Okay, so he was the leader, and this organization started for campaigning of the rights of the Tamil for their own independent homeland. Now in 2009, after a lot of bloodshed was there, 2009, finally the Sri Lankan government was able to defeat LTTE, And in this conflict, the 3 decades conflict was there almost. The Civil War is one of the longest running civil wars in the Asia. Then coming to the last topic, that is Freedom Pineapple Campaign. It was started by the president of Taiwan to counter China's ban on the import of Taiwanese pineapples. So China banned the imports of the pineapples from Taiwan in March 2021 with the allegation of the risk of pests. China said that there were pests in the pineapples from Taiwan, and therefore it had banned the imports of these pineapples. ठीक है, तो in in response that the Taiwan has launched this Freedom Pineapple Campaign. So the idea of the Freedom Pineapple Campaign is to attract more consumers to buy and consume the fruits locally. So more people should buy the pineapple from Taiwan so that the Taiwan does not need to export it to the China. This is the main idea. So the idea is to consume all the pineapples within the country itself. A social media campaign was also launched, freedom hashtag freedom pineapple, and Taiwan exports almost 10% of the pineapple it grows annually to, and most of the exports go to China. Okay, so this ban is a huge impediment in the growth of the Taiwanese pineapple industry. Now the last topic is the United Nations Institute for Training and Research, that is UNITAR. It was established in 1963, and its objective is to provide innovative learning solutions to individuals, organizations and institutions for enhanced global decision making and support country level action for shaping a better future. So basically, it's an organization which provides solutions for global decision making. So it provides inputs for decision making, and it provides the countries with the important information so that they can take good decisions which can help in the better future. Over the years, it has acquired a unique expertise and experience in designing and delivering a variety of training activities for both public and private sectors. It launched a new 4-year strategic framework, 4-year strategic framework from 2018 to 2021, and this aligned with the 2030 agenda and uses sustainable development goals as the guiding principles. Okay. So it was organized around 4 out of 5 thematic pillars of the 2030 agenda, that is the peace, people, planet and prosperity. These are the 4 important pillars around which the 4-year strategic framework was founded: peace, people, planet and prosperity. So its headquarters are in Geneva, and it does not receive any funds from the regular United Nations budget, and it is financed entirely from the voluntary contributions from the United Nations members, United Nations agencies and international and intergovernmental organizations, foundations, NGOs and private sector. So basically it is purely based on funds, donations, and it does not receive any funds from the United Nations budget. So with this, we conclude the discussion for today's class. I hope that you have learned a lot, and if you have learned it, then please share this video to among your friends so that they also get to learn something new. Thank you, and we will meet in the next video.